please join me in welcoming Steve Lekson.
Is this working? Now we have a technology moment. Make this work. Hold on here. Help. All right. And I don't control the lights, but that fine gentleman does. Thank you for coming out tonight. Launch right into this, because it's sort of long and hopefully not long, but convoluted. I've been interested in how to write narrative histories for prehistoric times. And prehistoric doesn't mean there was no history, it just means that there's no documents. So I've been working quite a bit lately on how do archaeologists, especially for the Southwest, which is my area, how could we do that? How could we write a narrative history? And I made an attempt with the History of Ancient Southwest to SAR Press, and I would recommend that you buy 10 copies of that book, another 10. That's 20 copies of that book. And one of the things that intrigues me are counterfactuals, which real historians think are parlor games, but they're what-if things. You know, what if the South had won the Civil War? That kind of thing. They're not unlike archaeological modeling, where computer modeling or simulations, where you can change a parameter or change a base value or change a rule, and it'll come out with different results, and you can learn a lot from doing that. That's very rigorous and formal and complicated and expensive. What if you just sit there, with a drink and go, what if? And it's cheap and fun. I'm going to do a number of what ifs to kind of move. I'm thinking about how we think about the Southwest. Archaeologists in particular, but people engaged with archaeology and the prehistory of the Southwest, and I expect you wouldn't be here if you weren't those people. How we conceptualize the Southwest. So, what if Popey got the job done? Popey, of course, is one of the leaders of the Pueblo Revolt, one of the most successful colonial revolts. In both North and South America, ran the Spanish all the way back to El Paso and practically back to Chihuahua. What if the Spanish had decided, well, okay, to hell with it, we don't want northern New Mexico anyway, there's nothing up there. We'll concentrate on Tucson. Popey runs them out of northern New Mexico. I don't know how well you can see this map, that's the Four Corners and Chihuahua and Texas. And what if Spanish interests had shifted to Tucson, and that became the sort of cultural capital of the Southwest? Well, the archaeology down there is really different. There's a whole other half of the Southwest. When we talk about the Southwest, the image that comes to most people's minds is Mesa Verde, northern New Mexico, things like that. But in the prehistoric times, in ancient times, 1000 AD, something like that, the action was really down south, under Phoenix and under Tucson, called Hohokam. That's an anglicized version of a native word down there. And it was some of the first known archaeology in the Southwest, too, in far as historical records go. Father Kino talks about Casa Grande, and I imagine many of you have seen this place. It's one of my favorite National Park Service units because of the amazing tin roof they built over this thing. And it was one of the first preserved archaeological sites in the Southwest before there was a Park Service, before there were national monuments. In 1892, they set aside Casa Grande. It was that famous to be preserved. And at first they built a little wood roof over it, and then they built this wonderful tin roof. I was under that thing once in a hailstorm, and it was absolutely stunning. But it's different than what you got up here. Different history, different culture, different civilization. Hohokam is very very Mexican, West Mexican, let's put it that way. The sites, one reason that Ansel Adams never took a picture of a Hohokam site, I suspect, because they mostly don't stick up like Casa Grande does. They're mostly flat as a pancake. You have to be an you have to do archaeology to see them. And when you excavate them, you get these little courtyard groups of three or four freestanding structures around a patio. Well, that's a courtyard group from West Mexico. I mean, that's a pattern of living, a style of a house that's really Mesoamerican. That's not how Pueblo people live. That's not how they live up here. But that's what Hohokam's all about, is that, these modules of courtyard groups. They go many steps beyond that, where they have ball courts. And I'm sure many of you have traveled in Mexico and have seen the ball courts at Chichen Itza or Tula, places like that. It's a version of the Mesoamerican ball game. The Hohokam ball courts are oval, and they're pretty. Some of them are pretty substantial. They're monumental structures. But again, it's not an influence from Mexico. And this is Mexican. Mexican's the wrong word. This is Mesoamerican, right down there in Tucson. The sites are enormous. Hohokam sites they go on for miles. The scale here is 350 meters. 350 meters, right? That's three football fields at scale. This is all one site. This is Aztatlan, one of the bigger Hohokam sites. For scale, that's Pueblo Bonito. All right? These things are enormous. All under Phoenix today. Unfortunately, it's all under parking lots and strip malls and stuff. But all under Phoenix is this. Phoenix is here. There's Tempe right there. You know, Scottsdale somewhere in there. This is the Salt River Valley. It's flowing from up in the mountains here down to meet the Gila River right about there. All these little spaghetti strips, let me clarify. All the little squares are 1 mile, 1 square mile for scale. All the spaghetti strips are canals. I mean, this is the real stinking desert. This is the Upper Sonoran Desert. It's great to farm if you get water to it. The water's in the Salt River. These guys engineered canals that were 40 feet wide and 20 feet deep and ran 20 miles. And every one of those things is a canal. I mean, they're very, very elaborate and impressive systems. Bill Doolittle, who studies irrigation in the New World, ancient irrigation in the New World, says you have to go down, there's nothing like this in Mexico. You have to go to Peru before you start seeing canal systems like this. All right? This is under Phoenix now. Towards the end of Hohokam, you get these huge platform mounds. This is one you can go see. It's right at the east end of the Phoenix airport. It's a city park. The size of a football field. They raised a football field 15 feet. That's a lot of dirt. And then built a palace on top of it. They built a building for important people, elite residences. This is very different than what we think we have up here. The local folks, the Oodham, we used to call Pima and Papago, they have stories about that. They have stories about these guys. These are the guys that lived there, towering over the surrounding villages, again, going for miles with these canals and all this kind of stuff. This is something on a Cecil B. DeMille scale compared to like Chaco or something like that. They have stories about that history where the people that were living on top, and this is the Vaughan cache, these are highly restored figurines, and they're really about like so. I think they came from the North Tucson Basin, but they're wearing turbans, they're wearing ball court gear. These are people that are people of the South. That these guys lived up on top of the mounds. The people that are today the Oodham, they were living in the city in the regular houses, in the courtyard groups, and these were oppressive rulers. I mean, these guys were not nice. And at one point, there is what is literally a class revolt. This is not how the Oodham tell the story, but there's a class revolt where the Oodham rise up, and they go from platform mound to platform mound, and they remember the sequence. They say, we went there to Casa Grande, we cut their heads off. We went over here to Pueblo Grande, we cut their heads off. It's like the French Revolution. I mean, this is a very different master narrative than we have for Mesa Verde. I mean, this is a very different master narrative. What if Pope had got the job done, and instead of the Four Corners being the master narrative for our vision of the Southwest, this was the master narrative. This is, Mesoamerican style stuff. You don't have the pyramids, but you have the monumental structures, you have these elaborate canal infrastructure, canal systems, you have class societies, you have revolts. There's stories of wars between Tucson and Phoenix. I mean, it's a real different master narrative, and we have a real different view of the Southwest if Tucson was the center. Let's move back just a step, a big step. Excuse me just a second here. What if archaeology in the Southwest had not come from Boston and Washington, D.C., or New York, but had come from Mexico City? If the archaeology had moved from the South to the North instead of from the East to the West? Mexico has a very different attitude towards its native populations, at least some of them, than we do. In Mexico, especially during the Diaz days and thereafter, they nationalized their past. Everyone's an Aztec, Okay? It's part of the national identity. Not everyone's a Taro Omar or a Yaqui, but everyone's an Aztec. They nationalized their past. used to be on all the, I can remember a time when I thought it was on almost all the folding money. Carl Sauer, the great cultural geographer, historical geographer who started the Berkeley School of American landscape geography, thought about this a lot, and this is a great quote from him. The notion of independence and isolation of the Southwest, which is our notion of the Southwest, it's floating out here, kind of isolated from everything else, would not have arisen, it seems to me, if historically Mexico had been the center from which anthropological studies had spread into North America instead of Boston or New York. Why is that? Well, what would Mexico have said, what would archaeology that originated from Mexico City have said about the Southwest? I can tell you. Alexander von Humboldt was one of the great men of the Enlightenment and known around the world, but not so much in the United States. I mean, I'm sure you all know who Humboldt is, but in Mexico, especially in Mexico City, he's like God. He traveled to Mexico. He was a geographer. No, he's a polymath, but he had a geographer hat that he wore. He went to Mexico City and through parts of South America and through Mexico, didn't make it to the United States except to visit his pal Tom Jefferson briefly, and then went back to Europe and wrote about it, published 18 huge volumes of his travels. And he published maps, pretty accurate maps, I don't know how you can see this, of the Southwest, for example. Our Southwest, this is the Rio Grande. We're up here someplace, I can't remember, but the maps are pretty accurate. This is kind of strange because he never made it to the Southwest. He never made it further north than Mexico City. What he was doing is he was looking at maps at the Royal Institute of Mining, which is their USGS, your US Geological Survey, their place, this is about 1800, where they collected all the maps, including pre-Columbian maps, including copies of pre-Columbian maps. He looked at all those maps. He was already famous, so every savant and every intellectual in Mexico City is leaning over his shoulder, helping him out. And the map that he produced from all that was pretty accurate, as far as latitudes go. The longitudes are off a little bit. But on that map of our Southwest, he has the first home of the Aztecs. Okay, someplace south of the San Juan River and east of its confluence with the Colorado. And, the big ruins there, there's a bunch, but Chaco question mark. For sure, Casa Grande, the one with the roof on it, the second home of the Aztecs. The third home of the Aztecs, Paquime or Casas Grandes, the great center just south of the border in Chihuahua, from whence they went through the land of the Tarahumara to Culiacan, which is a whole other story. This was I think you could take this as the consensus intellectual position of the Mexican intelligentsia, which in Mexico City at 1800 was an incredibly cosmopolitan place. I mean, it's just a marvelous place full of universities and academies and, centers of learning. That this would be the consensus, as whispered into Humboldt's ear, of what the Southwest was. It was Aztlan, where the Aztecs came from. That's the Aztec story of their origins. They came from up north. Well, Nuevo Mexico, that would probably be what Mexico would say about our Southwest, Los Dos Mexicos. This is from a web page, I don't think it's a museum exhibit, about Casas Grandes and about, there's the one Mexico and there's the other Mexico, which is where we're sitting right now. So I think if archaeology proceeded from south to north instead of from east to west, that's probably how you'd see the Southwest. It wouldn't be a big thing to say, oh, Mesoamerican contact in the Southwest. Of course, it's all part of Mesoamerica, it's all part of Mexico. But that didn't happen. Because, what if? James K. Polk beat Henry Clay in the election of 1846. Polk is an amazing president. He had four policy issues. He said, I'm going to get it all done in one term. He was going to get New Mexico and California. He was going to get Oregon. One had to do with banking. Something he was going to demolish the central bank, and I forget what the other one was. He got them all done. I'm mostly interested in his territorial expansions, which led to the Mexican War. He got them all done in one term. Hardly ever left his office. He had a cot in his office he slept in. Said, after one term, that's it. I got you California, New Mexico. I got you Oregon. We almost fought two wars. We almost fought one war with Mexico and one with Britain over Oregon, but he managed to negotiate that. He lasted about 6 weeks after he got out of office and dropped dead. That's a good president. Did what he said he was going to do and got the hell out of there. He got us all this. He took a third of Mexico from Mexico, and he took all this from you know, Oregon was what we call Washington and Oregon today. He got all that. Jefferson got you this. Jefferson got you that. Polk got the rest. I don't know if Polk was such a nice guy, but he certainly wasn't influential as Jefferson, but he deserves a monument someplace. But it also established a border between us and them. And the first thing we did was nationalize that archaeology around here. The Archaeological Institute of America was founded in 1879. The next year, I think, they sent Adolph Bandelier, the guy that Bandelier National Monument is named after, out to survey in the Southwest to see what, they'd been hearing about all these ruins, Aztlan, the home of the Aztecs, and all this stuff. They've been hearing about that back east. And that was actually accepted by many East Coast intellectuals. Prescott, in History Conquest of Mexico, has a footnote about how, those ruins in New Mexico, that's probably where the Aztecs came from. That was pretty much consensus among the guys that were writing in the mid 19th century. And Bandelier came out here, and one of the things he was supposed to check out was, what about those ruins? That's where the Aztecs came from? And Bandelier said, no. He came out here and looked at them. Bandelier, this is a what if, I'm not going to follow out. He never made it to Chaco. He never made it to Mesa Verde. He was aware of Chaco. He was aware of it. We never made it out there. But he said, no, there were no Mexican, there were certainly a Spanish colonial presence in New Mexico, but there were no Aztecs in New Mexico. All those ruins that people have been, he called the romantic view of Southwestern archaeology. The romantic view of Southwestern archaeology, that's just balderdash. Those are just the old homes of the Pueblo people, the ancestral Pueblo thing. I call that the Great Wall. He nationalized the ruins. They were our ruins, but God, they weren't Mexico's. Humboldt's map would suggest they were Mexico's, they were Aztec. No, those are ours. And built a wall intellectually. This is touchy stuff these days. Built a wall intellectually where we're trying to build a wall physically today in between the two countries. Okay, we'll come back to that. Here's another what if, and this is a critical branching point for prehistory, for writing narrative history in the Southwest. What if the ancient Southwest and archaeology in the United States, what if it had been affiliated not with anthropology, but with history? In Europe, archaeology, surely that's history. Well, no. No, archaeology is anthropology, and anthropology is not history. Anthropology is a natural science discipline. History's over there in the humanities. Archaeology in the old world, in Europe, historically been associated with history. That's what they think of themselves. They think of themselves mostly, until recent decades, and even now, mostly, we're part of history. We're a branch of history. Archaeology in the United States, dealing with those mound builders back east and these so-called Aztec ruins out west, they were shoveled off into natural history disciplines, into anthropology. That's in part because we thought Native Americans had no history. They were specimens to be studied. There was no history to write. And this guy was a big part of that. This is I have a wardrobe malfunction. Hopefully not serious. Is that working? Okay. Need to quit twitching my ears. This is Lewis Henry Morgan, who is the father of American anthropology. And Morgan was self-taught. Everybody's self-taught at that point, and that's no sin in that. There was no anthropology to be learned, but he was a self-taught anthropologist who said, Native Americans, it's almost like Indianology. Native American Indians belonged in anthropology. Forget about history, all right? He made sure that it was a science. He made anthropology part of the American Association for the Academy of Advancement of Science, AAAS, of which he was president at one point. That's how he got that one through. Anthropology was situated in the sciences, had nothing to do with history, and he said, if you want to know about the past, what past there was, if you want to know about the past, the only way you're going to know about it is what he called the ethnological method, which is taking Indians as they existed when he knew them in the 19th century, their social structures, their kinship systems, all that kind of stuff, and then puzzling out how that might have come together from the past, like historical linguistics recreates proto-languages and stuff like that. This is a method that's time-honored, and I know John Ware is here. I think that it's still being practiced today, where you take the present and puzzle out from what would happen in the past that would create that present. Which is useful if, you know, if your main question or your only question is, you know, where'd the Pueblos come from? Which is a good question. But it's not the only question in the Southwest. It's not the only question in the Southwest. I will argue, before this is over, that an equally good question is, what the heck is Chaco? And it may or may not have anything to do with that first question, with, you know, where did the Pueblos come from? It has a history of its own. What this does is it says there's no history, that anything that happened in the past had to lead to this configuration in the present. If you think about history is all about stuff that didn't make it. I mean, Italy is not Rome. It's not the Rome of the ancient Romans. Italy's a very interesting place, very interesting government. But it's heir to Rome, and it has all the Roman sites. But it's not Rome. I mean, Rome came and went. That kind of stuff happens everywhere, including the Southwest. But by putting the past in the Southwest into anthropology instead of history, we foreclosed on that. We can't let ourselves know that. And I'll hammer that home. The other thing he said was he had a system of ranking societies from savagery, barbarism, and civilization, and he didn't mean that pejoratively, it's just terms. You know, there's savagery, and there's barbarism, and there's civilization. He said that no society in the New World ever achieved civilization, which is a state. He said none, including the Aztecs, all right? They always stuck in middle barbarism. Yeah, they had, you know, lower, middle, and upper savagery, lower, middle, and upper barbarism, lower, middle, and upper civilization. And, you know, upper civilization was Victorian England, of course. But he said no civilizations, which, of course, down south in Mexico, they just said, you're nuts, and they paid no attention to it. But north of the border, north of that Great Wall, that stuck. That we teach our students in Archaeology 101, there were no states north of Mexico. It's dogma. It's dogma pure and simple. We just say it, that no states north of Mexico. Before we close on that, I call that the glass ceiling. So you got the Great Wall, and it's actually Great Wall's plural, and the glass ceiling. And there it is. I don't claim to be an artist. You know, let a boy loose with PowerPoint and you're in trouble. There's the glass ceiling, and there's walls, really. Because it's not just that America, north of Mexico is, you know, entire unto itself, and there's no one's denying that they knew about each other, but there's no important historical dynamic there. There's also walls between the Southwest and the Mississippi Valley, and, you know, walls between, even within the Southwest, between ancestral Pueblo or Anasazi and Hohokam. Oh, they couldn't have known about each other. Well, nonsense. Okay, this is all going to hopefully come together. Or if I'm lucky, we'll run out of time, and I'll just have to say, oh, gosh, good. Another what if. What if Edgar Hewitt had stayed in Greeley, Colorado, which is where he was teaching school, when he met Cora Whitford, his first wife? This is a sad story. She was a teacher. He was a teacher there in Greeley, which is way northern Colorado. And she had tuberculosis. She had TB. And so he came, he brought there was no cure for TB, but what you did is you brought people to drier and drier climates. And Greeley's pretty dry, but it wasn't dry enough. So he brought her down to northern New Mexico, and they both fell in love with the place. Unfortunately, she didn't live very long to enjoy it, but he fell in love with the place. So he relocates from Greeley to Santa Fe, where he becomes a really big fish in a really small pond. And it was a really small pond. That's Santa Fe. That's a nice picture of Santa Fe in the late 19th century. Here's an account of Santa Fe in the mid-18th century. The town itself is no size at all. Some adobe houses all grouped around a plaza containing the governor's palace, the bishop's palace, dozens of stores and posadas. From a very reliable first-hand source, some of you may recognize, some of you may not. Edgar Hewitt finds this place, falls in love with it, and it's just a little, dusty town at that point. It's, population's like 1,000 or 1,500, something like that. And says hot dog. He's not saying hot dog because his wife is sick, and there's other reasons for him getting lost in his work. But he is the founder of the School of American Archaeology, which turns into the institution that has you here tonight, the School for Advanced Research. He took the Museum of New Mexico, which existed technically, I think it was a couple of closets in the governor's palace, and turned it into an institution. Founded the Department of Anthropology at the University of New Mexico. He's an empire builder. You all have heard of this guy, and I'm sure you know. This is just maybe not the tip of the iceberg, but it's only the top third of the iceberg of the stuff that he was involved with. He was definitely a culture broker. He, again, was self-taught, like almost all these guys were. He considered himself an anthropologist, archaeologist. He is a follower of Morgan, who was the guy that said there were no civilizations, and that he's a follower of Bandelier. Bandelier was a student of Morgan's. Hewitt was a student of Bandelier's, and Hewitt worshipped Morgan. I mean, he knew about Morgan long before he even met Bandelier. So, you know, Hewitt's politics were, yeah, there's no civilizations. You know, Mexico is interesting, but irrelevant for understanding what happened in the Southwest. But it's not that intellectual lineage that I'm interested in. It's more his culture broker stuff. That, and this is a long story that I can't get into, but wait, you know, a book will come out, and you can read it. Buy 10 copies of it and read it, read all 10 copies. He was one of a handful of people, but he's identified, and there's a whole genre of literature. I mean, there are many, many sources for this. They may all be wrong, but I'm not making this up. That, maybe a dozen or a score of people involved in Santa Fe who are not Pueblo people, and they are not mainly Hispanic people, but they were trying to market Santa Fe. And, okay, they're trying to market Santa Fe because the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railroad never got to Santa Fe. But the railroad did get to Albuquerque. And all of a sudden, Albuquerque booms. It becomes the center. It's got the industry. It's got the momentum. It's the modern town. Santa Fe's this dusty little place like Harry Flashman described it still. And people in here's how it falls out. I mean, Albuquerque gets the university. Santa Fe gets the penitentiary. All right? People in Albuquerque, the movers and shakers in Albuquerque, wanted to move the capital down there, which just happens. Capitals move. I mean, at least you could get to Albuquerque. It was on the railroad. You know, you couldn't get to Santa Fe. And why would you want to go there? Because we had culture. You had culture. Town had culture. That's what they had. I mean, these guys got together, not these guys, but Hewitt and the town fathers got around and said, well, we can't beat them in science. We can't beat them in being modern. We can't beat them in industry. We have the culture. Which culture? Well, originally, initially, and, you know, this is, again, there's a literature on this. They decided to go with Spanish. Let's do Spanish. And they, you know, tarted up the plaza, and they changed the fiesta, and they did, you know, they manipulated stuff to emphasize Spanish. Well, nobody's buying that. On the West Coast, if you want to see Spanish, you just drive down the road and you go see the missions, and you can see these big Baroque, you know, missions. East Coast, if you want to see Spanish, you just get on Mr. Flagler's Railroad and you go down to St. Augustine. You know, who the heck wants to come to Santa Fe to see Spanish? So they said, okay, no, you know, wrong on that one. This is the ticket right here. We'll go for Indians. And boy, did they go for Indians. Everything I'm saying here is all from a white people's view on Indians. It's not like the Indians are passive or, you know, they have no say in this matter, but what I'm talking about is how we constructed a view, a non-Indian view, of how Indians work, especially Pueblo Indians. Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe got on board with Fred Harvey. I mean, they never, you know, they ran a spur up to Lamy, but it never actually reached Santa Fe, yeah, it wasn't just Santa Fe doing the marketing. Santa Fe Railroad wanted to get people in their seats. They hire Fred Harvey. You all know that story. And if you don't, go over to the museum. The History Museum's got a great exhibit on Fred Harvey and how they invent the Southwest. They invented the Southwest. They invented this Southwest that we have today. It sure as heck isn't the Southwest you'd have if you were coming from Tucson, remember? I mean, that's a totally different Southwest. They invented this Southwest, which I call Pueblo Space. And it's a bunch of people. And again, wait till the book comes out. You can read about all these guys. And they didn't all get along. You know, it's not like a big conspiracy. They didn't all get along, but they're all pushing at the same sort of thing. You know, John Galmeem and Erna Ferguson, she was working with Fred Harvey's people. There's Fred right there. And Mabel Dodge Lujan, Ken Chapman, and the gang here in Santa Fe. And Charles Lummis, who was a pal of Hewitt's and a writer of some influence. And they create what one scholar calls the Pueblo Mystique. I call it the Pueblo Space because the Pueblo Mystique, here's the Pueblo Mystique / Space, independent, inward-looking, egalitarian, communal, spiritual, all kinds of things that appealed to us in the early 20th century. They're making this up in the early 20th century now, you know, like 19-teens, 1920s. You know, you're coming off of World War I, which is ghastly, although U.S. was spared most of that. Coming off the start, you know, the depression, all that, or you're in the middle of the depression, the rise of the dictators at that point, and we may be seeing that again, who knows. This is very appealing. And it got an official scholarly boost from Ruth Benedict, who wrote what I think is probably the most influential book, anthropology book on the Southwest, ever published. Even the Southwest is only one quarter of the book. She looked at four different societies, and she's playing games with culture and personality that we don't need to go into here, but her depiction of Zuni reached not just, you know, millions of people in the United States. The book got translated into I don't know how many languages. It's still in print. It's getting translated into more and more languages. Her vision of Zuni was very much that Pueblo Space vision. Communal, spiritual, egalitarian, Zen, you know, Zen gardeners. She doesn't say that. But, you know, that really, okay, that's the official pronouncement. Anthropology honors her as a pioneer of woman anthropologists, but not her vision of Zuni. But that's her vision of Zuni. The genie's out of the bottle. It's out there. That's what people believe. It gets hammered home from Hopi, which we probably don't talk about much in Santa Fe. But popular books about Hopi, like Frank Waters, who was, of course, a Taos guy, reached lots and lots and lots of people, and it's that same Pueblo space picture, this picture of Pueblo people, you know, in that space that we invented. And then Tom Mayles with a whole bunch of books. These appealed, okay, Hopi is the furthest west Pueblo, closest to San Francisco. These appealed to the hippies and Hopis. And I got a whole chapter on this. It's just a fascinating story. But the hippies get hold of, especially the Haight-Ashbury guys, there's a connection between Haight-Ashbury and Hopi. Hippies pick up on this stuff. It sounds really good. And what is it they're picking up on? They're not initially talking to Hopis. They're reading about Hopis in this romanticized Pueblo space that is being wrung for all it's worth by those authors. And you know, eventually a bunch of hippies come out to Hopi, and they are going to plan, I shouldn't get off on this tangent because the story's too good, but they're planning a big hippie Hopi be-in. And the Hopis are being very polite, but there's, you know, they're going, yes, you need to talk to this other person, not me. I think it would be great fun to go out among some of the older Hopis and ask them what they remember about the hippies. But anyway, you know, it goes global. The Pueblo space goes global. I mean, it, you know, we can't control it. Well, can ever control it, but that's the way the world thinks about Pueblos now, is this vision of Pueblos that comes mainly from white people, tail end of the 19th and early 20th century, here in Santa Fe, and in Flagstaff and Sedona and places like that. But archaeology operates in that Pueblo space, whether we like it or not. That's the view of, you know, that defines polite discourse in archaeology. there's you know, Pueblo space is definitely under the glass ceiling, and it's, you know, behind the great walls. It's isolated. It's inward. It's egalitarian. The archaeology jargon is it's a middle range societies, medium scale societies. Well, that doesn't work with Chaco. I mean, this is why we have to think like historians and not like anthropologists. And my main thrust of this next book is that we need to get the ancient past, the past of North America, as it is known by non-native people, okay? Again, all this talk I'm certainly engaging public people, but I'm talking about how non-native people see this past. We have to think about it historically and not anthropologically. We can be informed by anthropology, but anthropology is a real drag on the market. It's really holding us back. Like Chaco, for example, and I assume most everybody here knows Chaco, but, you know, out in the middle of northwest New Mexico, it's not going to look like that much longer. There's going to be oil wells all around it, which is a whole other story. But you got this 8-mile-long canyon that has no amenities, no particular reason for anybody to live out there, but a lot of people are living out there, and some of them, there's half a dozen, this is not one of the big ones, but half a dozen huge buildings we call great houses, because that's what they were great houses, and a whole bunch of smaller great houses. I suspect I don't need to go much further into that. Chaco doesn't fit in there. And I'll make that argument that's the rest of this talk. The Chaco doesn't fit in there. It doesn't fit in Pueblo space. It doesn't fit under the glass ceiling. Those walls are nonsense. And we've known this for a while. And the way we've gotten around it is to ritualize everything. We turn Chaco into a pilgrimage center. We've turned Chaco into a ceremonial center. Somehow for us, okay, this isn't Pueblo people saying this is what Chaco was. This is us being comfortable working, us being archaeologists, working inside Pueblo space, seeing something that's totally anomalous and saying, oh, well, if it's ceremony, it's okay. That's all right. You know, if we just make it ritual, then it's all right. It's not. What if Chaco escaped Pueblo space? Okay, I got 10 fun facts about Chaco. I'm going to give them give them to you in groups of three or four, and then talk about them a little bit, and how not a one of them fits in Pueblo space. And again, Pueblo spaces are construct, okay? I have to keep emphasizing that. Great houses are real and really different. I mean, some people want to turn great houses into farming villages, and they're not. Great houses were houses, all right? People living in the great houses were special, and there weren't that many of them. And I'll show you this in a second. Chaco was a stratified class society. The people living in the great houses were one class of people. People who were living in other kinds of houses were another class of people. Where's your evidence? Where's your evidence for that? Well, the evidence is stacked up 30 feet high. It's like, you know, 50,000 tons of sandstone and mud stacked 30 feet high over an area the size of a Major League Baseball field. That's Pueblo Bonito. That's one of the six big ones out there. Six. Six. There we go. Right number of fingers. All you have to do is walk through Pueblo Bonito, walk across the canyon, and go into the houses that normal people lived in, and walk through those. And the difference is absolutely slap you upside the head stark. I mean, there's no ambiguity here. That is one class of people, or certainly one class of building and another class of building. And their houses, there's lots of ancillary evidence. Have I been fading in and out? Oh, okay, because I just realized the microphone's bobbing here. It escaped. Pueblo space makes it very difficult for some of my colleagues to see that building. I mean, I stood right in front of it, and they say, what's your evidence for saying there's two classes of people? And look. I mean, it's totally unambiguous. The difference is between, it's stark, the difference between that kind of building and this kind of building, where you could take one of these single-family houses, smoosh it all down, and fit it in a single room of that great house. All right? The great houses, the walls are, you know, 3 feet thick and 40 feet tall, and the rooms are huge and tall ceilings. You know, the walls on this are one stone thick and 4 feet tall, and, you know, I'm sure it's a fine house if that's what you're used to. But, it's not that. So you got two kinds of housing. You've got a social pyramid where there's a lot less people living, even though it's a huge place. There's a lot less people. There may be 12 families living in here. There could be 12 families living in here. Commoner families, noble families. I use those words. I'll use a word like king, and my colleagues will just shudder, all right, because it doesn't fit in Pueblo space. But if you look at what's going on in North America, by that I mean America north of Panama, all right, in the 11th century, which is when all this is taking place, all these societies had commoners and nobles. I mean, that was not the default. That was the ubiquitous social arrangement. There was a noble class and a commoner class, and some other classes too. But it doesn't work in Pueblo space, the Pueblo space that we created. That, you know, we can't see that in the ancient Southwest because it doesn't fit in that self-imposed limitation. Okay, a few more fun facts about Chaco. Chaco outliers, which are great house buildings that are outside Chaco, those are real and define Chaco's region. Roads, which I'll show you in a minute, and line of sight signaling shows us that Chaco, that region, was a system. I'll show you a map where all how this works. Its region included about 60,000 people, and that's a modest estimate. You know, maybe 100,000 people are in this region of which Chaco was the center, the clear center. Again, that's unambiguous. The outliers are like you take a 20th of Pueblo Bonito and take them away from pick it up with a giant helicopter, drop it in the middle of a whole bunch of commoner houses, and it sticks out like a sore thumb, a very large sore thumb. If you've been to Mesa Verde, this is one, Farview House. All around Farview House, there's a bunch of little commoner houses, some of which the University of Colorado dug. And that's a common pattern. I'll show you a road. This is one of the sites in Chaco. This is Peñasco Blanco, this oval thing. And a road, you know, we call them roads because they look like roads, but they're not roads like you drove in on. They're linear earthen monuments that connect one site with another site. There's history written on the ground, and there are also politics written on the ground. The roads, I'll show you in a minute, the roads radiate out from Chaco like spokes on a wheel. That means they also radiate into Chaco like spokes on, you know, into a hub. But that's a road right there. That's a Chaco road. I mean, some of them are, you know, easy to see. Most of them are not so easy to see, which is a complication with all the fracking that's about to happen out there. But it's a different story. Okay, here's a map of Chaco, which is about the size of Indiana, or Ireland, if you wish. You can see it, but that faint blue line is the outermost line of all these little red dots are those outliers. The red lines are roads, and there's a lot more roads out there. I mean, there's a lot more roads. We just haven't, you know, thrown the money at them to document them. And then Chaco is a very clear center in the middle of it all. All right? So it's fun facts about Chaco. I'll come back and, you know, I'll spill the beans at this point and say, Pueblos never did anything like that. That doesn't fit in Pueblo space. You don't have one center and, you know, 100,000 or 60,000 people to answer to that center, however they're answering. That's not in the Pueblo space of independent agricultural villages with egalitarian, you know, communal social structures. It doesn't work. The road system, probably this whole area, I mean, we know the north better than we know the south, and the east, south and the west. It was linked by a line-of-sight signaling system, and I got a chance to work at this place, which is now a national monument, and not because I worked there, but it became a national monument after we worked there. If you haven't seen it, it's worth seeing, up near Pagosa Springs in Colorado. This is the Chaco Great House. There are hundreds of smaller, commoner houses all on these lower slopes, all around this thing. And out at the end of the knife-edge ridge that they built this thing on are these two huge natural sandstone pillars that do interesting things with astronomy, if you're into that sort of thing. That's not what I'm showing you here, this for. Right here, actually, on the far side of that old, that's a Forest Service fire watch tower. Right out here is a great big firebox, about the size of a, you remember a kid's sandbox? About the size of that, sandstone lined, just cherry red. It had been burned and burned and burned and burned and burned. And they were not toasting marshmallows. They were signaling with it from Chimney Rock. And this is standing in Chimney Rock. And you build a fire, and you can see this very distinctive landform, Huerfano, which is a sacred mountain for the Navajo people. And you can see Huerfano from all over the northern San Juan Basin. It's, you know, it's a real landmark. From Chimney Rock, you can see Huerfano. From Chaco, you can see Huerfano. From Chimney Rock, you cannot see Chaco. From Chaco, you cannot see Chimney Rock. There's this intermediate station here that's necessary. When I was working at Chaco, we were working at Pueblo Alto, and our view to the north was Huerfano. When I was working at Chimney Rock, the view to the, whatever that would be, the southeast, southwest, was Huerfano. Okay, on top of Huerfano are more of these big fireboxes. There's not a great house there. There's not a community of Chaco people. There's more of these big red fireboxes. And at Pueblo Alto, where we work, there are great big fireboxes. This is a line of sight signaling system. And I'm saying it's a system because there had to be somebody to pick up the phone here, all right? I mean, I could want to talk to Chaco and build my fire, and if somebody wasn't there to light the repeater, Chaco would never know. So, you know, somebody's up there manning this, you know, once every month. Who knows? Who knows what the schedule was? Maybe 24 hours a day. Who knows? But somebody had to be there when the message was being sent to relay the message. And I think that line of sight signaling goes out in all different directions. I mean, it's best documented here, but every place we look, there are these big fireboxes on high points. Okay, two more fun facts. We're almost done. Chaco had bulk and prestige economies. Okay, Pueblos, our view of the Pueblos. This has nothing to do with how Pueblos really work, but our view of the Pueblos is that, yeah, they trade a little pottery, but mostly they make everything that they need. They're self-sufficient. They're inward-looking. They're, you know, they're not engaged in big market economies and stuff. Well, Chaco had bulk economies and prestige economies, and Chaco is not a great place to grow corn. I mean, here you have this city of 5,000 people out in the middle of the San Juan Basin, and it's not a good place to grow corn. I mean, people that want to turn Pueblo Bonito into a farming village, that's fine, except you can't farm. Okay, stuff that went into Chaco in bulk. And, you know, we know this from the archaeology. Labor. Those great, great houses were not built by the people that lived in them. The people that lived in them were, you know, 12 families who ate better, were taller, had a lot more stuff, and didn't do a lot of work, I suspect. Labor came into the canyon. Beams. I'll come back to beams. This is a really good case. Each one of those big buildings required hundreds of thousands of telephone poles to be brought in from mountains far away. I mean, there's no forest at Chaco. I'll come back to that. Pottery, at some time periods, especially towards the end, at least half the pottery for sure was not made at Chaco, and probably almost all of it was not made in Chaco. And this kind of makes sense because there's not a lot of fuel in Chaco. It takes a lot of fuel to fire a pot. If you're going to do that, you want to do it somewhere else. But it's, you know, it's not a question of efficiencies, of craft economies. It's a question of other people are making the pottery. Chaco is consuming the pottery. lithics, even the stone that they made arrowheads and things out of, that was coming in. There's some decent stone, not decent stone for some purposes at Chaco, some petrified wood. But, you know, anything that was nice was coming from somewhere else, sometimes long way away. Maize, corn, it's possible, well, it's difficult, and there's some difficulties with it, to determine from chemistry where corn was grown. And Larry Benson, who's a colleague of mine up in Boulder, sourced a bunch of corn with Linda Cordell. And every year of corn that they source is not grown at Chaco. It's grown somewhere else, which makes sense because Chaco, you know, climatically, you know, Chaco just doesn't get enough water for growing corn. Plus, the soil's no good. Meat. Dina Grimstead has sourced, again, chemically, where meat's coming from. Well, the meat's getting brought in. You know, like sides of beef is getting brought into the canyon. These are all bulk things. We're not talking about feathers. I'll talk about feathers in a second here, but these are all bulk things, and especially let's think about, for example, beams. To build those great houses and the other stuff that's out there, it isn't all just great houses. There's other monumental structures. Excuse me. It's 250,000 beams. They're not all telephone poles, but a lot of them are. And all those were coming from far away. Just recently, a bunch of guys, I'm forgetting the fellow's first name, Gitterman. Bob Gitterman, how about that? I might actually be Robert Gitterman, I can't remember. And some others were able to source where the beams are coming from. And these numbers, these numbers that you're seeing up here add up to 100. That's the percentage of beams from Chaco that are coming from here. 42% of the wood from Chaco came from the Chusca Mountains, which is, you know, 60 miles away. 28% came from the Zuni Mountains. You know, so most of it's coming from the west or the south, but, you know, a bunch of it's coming from, 10% is coming from the San Juan Mountains, which is, you know, here's a scale, 50 kilometers. I mean, that's a long way to carry a beam. And these people had roads, but they didn't have wheeled vehicles, they had beasts of burden. These beams are being carried. They're being ported into Chaco on people's back, well, with people's muscles. I don't know what was on their backs, or they're hanging them off of yokes or whatever. You know, Jemez Mountains, beams are coming from there, from the Gubernador. They're coming from all over, all around this region. And they're coming into Chaco in large, large quantities. That's one of many things. All those things I listed, you know, corn, pottery, all that stuff's going into Chaco. And then some more important stuff is going into Chaco and coming back out. Some of those other things are coming, beams aren't coming back out. Some of the other things, like possibly the maize and maybe some of the pottery and maybe some of the stone is coming back out of Chaco, but, you know, basically it's this prestige stuff. It's going into Chaco and some's coming back out and going out to the outliers, going out to the secondary centers. It's famous for turquoise. Chaco, the turquoise sources are not in Chaco. Turquoise sources, you know, one of the main ones is here in Cerrillos. You know, Chaco's a heck of a long way from there, but Sharon Hull and some other people are working on this, and they get, you know, Chaco's getting turquoise from Nevada, it's getting turquoise from Colorado, it's getting turquoise from Arizona, it's getting turquoise from all over. Probably most of it's from Cerrillos, but you know, their reach is very long. Their region, their extractive region anyway, is very long. And then other sorts of precious things. I said there was a wall between ancestral Pueblo or Anasazi and Ho'okam. I described Ho'okam right off the bat. Remember, that's the civilization that had all the canals and stuff. And you know, if we'd known Ho'okam before we knew ancestral Pueblo, we'd have a different view of the Southwest, that's for sure. But there's no sherds. There's no sherds of Ho'okam at Chaco, and there's no Chaco sherds at Ho'okam, but you stop to think about it, you know, why would they trade pots? They all had pots. It's like Coles to Newcastle. Oh, you brought me a pot. Oh, how nice. You know, I'll put it with my other 56 pots. There's other kinds of things, precious things, like Ho'okam did amazing weaving work. This is not from Chaco. This is, what was this from? Tonto Cliff Dwellings, I believe. But it's an open work, very distinctive Ho'okam woven shirt. Well, here's the same thing from Chetraquetl. It just, you know, wasn't cared for quite as well, but that's what this is. This is a fragment of one of these Ho'okam shirts. So it's not the pots and the quotidian things that are going to show us the prestige economies. It's the prestige stuff. You know, hey, I got a fancy Ho'okam shirt. That's okay. You can keep your pot. You know, but it's that level of stuff. Okay. Chaco is cosmopolitan. We're on the home stretch. Chaco is cosmopolitan. What does that mean? Well, it wasn't inward-looking, it was outward-looking. It was very much connected with its hemisphere. I'm sure you've read about a lot of this stuff, but you know, you get lots of ocean shell. Well, fine, everybody has ocean shell. But you get spondylus, which is, you know, way far south, and a shell which is very much valued by both in Mesoamerica, the high civilizations of Mesoamerica and South America. And of course, copper, this is a drawing of a copper bell. The copper bells are really about the size of a dime, and probably coming from West Mexico, but a copper bell sounds like a gewgaw or trinket, but no, I mean, copper was incredibly important stuff in its home country in Mesoamerica, Western Mexico. And it's probably the same, you know, the only important people have copper objects up here. Patty Crown, who's a professor down, Patricia Crown, who's a professor down at the University of New Mexico, has documented cacao, chocolate. All right, being consumed in these cylinder bases with which I'm making these numbers up, and it's not right, but hopefully you're not recording this. There are 200 or so cylinder bases, and 198 of them are from Pueblo Bonito in Chaco Canyon. I mean, this is something that was for those people in those great houses. The nobles in the great houses, at the end of their working day, you know, it's 5 o'clock, it's cacao time. Let's knock back a little cacao. The vases are interesting because that's the form that they drink cacao in the Maya country. And it's the same thing in the Maya country. Cacao is for important people. Cacao is even used for money. As a unit, you know, as a unit of money. Only important people have that stuff. The same areas that produce cacao produce these guys, these macaws, which Chaco had quite a few of. The macaws didn't fly up there. They're tropical birds. I don't know if there's any macaw fanciers in the room, but they're difficult birds. They don't like people very much. But they talk, which is something, which we have to think about, that they could be like a crazy eight ball or something. Should we go to war? No. But they mostly are after the feathers. And feathers, we think of feathers like fluff, you know, featherweight. But feathers were more important than gold for, well, that's probably an exaggeration, but for Aztecs Mesoamerican elites, the feathers told who you were. And if you were caught wearing a quetzal feather when you weren't supposed to wear a quetzal feather, short trip to the top of the pyramid or something, I don't know. So cosmopolitan, here's a little Chaco guy. He wants to be this guy. And in some way he is. He wants to be that guy. Chaco and both the nobles and the commoners in Chaco and everybody in the Southwest from the beginning of the Southwest knew there were cities to the south. How could they not know? That Great Wall was not there, all right? I mean, to think that the people of the Southwest were somehow ignorant of the existence of cities in Mesoamerica is sort of insulting to those ancient people. Of course they knew. When they develop class societies up here, what does that mean, develop class societies? I mean, it's sort of co-evolving, I think. It's part of a much larger development over most of North America where you have nobles and commoners, and they're doing it too. I don't think they're looking at Chaco saying, oh, they have nobles down south, we'll do that. It's probably all happening at once, although there were certainly nobles down south for 1,000 years before Chaco was a twinkle in anybody's eye. I mean, that was the existing social structure, was nobles and commoners, nobles and commoners. I mean, it would not be the least bit unnatural for these guys. They would know that. That was the world they knew. They didn't know about Pueblo space. We hadn't invented that yet, all right? They knew about nobles and commoners. So it's not that he wanted to be this guy. He is this guy. He's just out in the boonies. He's out on the extreme edge of it all. I mean, this guy, who I think is West Mixtec, I think, would probably laugh at you know, his pretensions, but they were both part of the same deal. He's a noble, he's a noble. It's just that he's a backwoods noble. So Pueblo space, independent, isolated, inward-looking, egalitarian, communal, spiritual, I don't know about spiritual. I have no idea. I don't think we can know. Chaco, none of the rest of that works for Chaco. Not a bit of it. I mean, Chaco needs to be Chaco. It can't fit in Pueblo space. The ethnological method's not going to get us to Chaco. I mean, if we say the past could only be things that would lead to the present, Chaco wasn't that. I mean, Pueblo people tell this story, or at least I interpret it this way, and certainly this is how I wrote the narrative history, is that Pueblos in part arose by rejecting Chaco. At 1300, they turned their back on that. They say, we don't want nobles anymore. It didn't work out very well. It ends badly. It ends with war and famine and all kinds of stuff. And Pueblo people reinvent themselves in something kind of like Pueblo space, but not, I mean, I won't pretend to know how Pueblos work. It's closer to this than it was to Chaco. So I'll end here here's, you know, give a boy PowerPoint, bad things happen. If we get Chaco out of Pueblo space, do you have patience for 5 minutes more? This is all leading somewhere. We'll never understand Chaco if we work inside public space, because it wasn't there. It was someplace else. It was trying to get over the wall and, you know, through the ceiling. If we go outside Pueblo space and you say, yeah, it was a class stratified society, which is no big deal, because almost all of them were in 1000 AD. That's not a big deal. That's not an extraordinary claim. It would be extraordinary if Chaco wasn't a class society. That's extraordinary. If we say that we can look to the south for models of what Chaco might have been, Chaco's no big mystery. I mean, we'd love to say it's a mystery. That fits with Pueblo space and flute music and all that stuff. But this archaeologist saying that for the present, the mystery of Chaco remains just that, a mystery. This really annoys me because we've been working out there for 100 years. You have paid a lot of money, okay? We get paid to figure these things out. Chaco is probably the best known archaeological site of its weight class anyway in the world, with, you know, all those tree ring dates and incredible preservation. This annoys me. If we just look to the south, you can find a model for Chaco that fits it like a glove. But you have to look at what, you know, state-level societies, what does that mean? You know, it means barely a state. This is not the Aztec Empire. This is just a polity that has nobles and commoners. And there's a thing, Anahua, which is Aztec, or the Aztec language anyway, a political system called an altepetl. And I'm mispronouncing that, but if there's any Anahua speakers in the room, you can... Then we'll go with altepetl, okay? Thank you. Very well documented. It's later than Chaco. The documented forms are later than Chaco, but Kenneth Hirth and a bunch of other people think it certainly exists earlier, where it's nobles and commoners. It's a class society. That's not a big deal. You know, every society is. But this is the interesting part. It's, you know, 5 to 8 noble families with a kind of rotating kingship. So there's not one king line of kingship. When the king dies, his son doesn't become king, or as we're hearing now, his wife's son, or it's matrilineal, so I don't know how that would work, but his son does not become king. The other leaders of each princely house get together and they elect a new king. And that keeps one of these half dozen families from dominating the society. It's a kind of leveling mechanism of the nobles, if that makes sense. It consists of a city and a countryside. It's some kind of concentrated center and a region. It's all one thing. Altepetl means the mountains, the waters. It's the whole ecology of the thing. There's tribute and taxes, where the people in the countryside owe some kind of tribute and taxes to the people in the nobles in charge, but not something onerous. You know, you're talking about a couple bushels of corn, or, you know, a week working on the guy's house or something like that, at least from what the historic records that we know. And the size of it, the central cities, Mike Smith has worked on a lot of this stuff, the central cities are like 3,000 to 5,000 people. That's Chaco. Chaco's, you know, 2,500 people, 3,000 people, something like that. So that fits. And for the whole polity, you know, 30 to 50,000 people. I said Chaco's region, 60,000 people. So, you know, those fit. All those things, they fit. The structure is what works, though. An altepetl down in central Mexico would have pyramids, and, you know, it would look Mexican, it would look Mesoamerican. It's the structure that fits, and it's translated into a local idiom, into the local architectural traditions, into the local philosophical traditions. But the structure is, you got this central cluster of, you know, half a dozen major palaces, each one representing a family, and they have like a pizza pie slice of the region that owes them tribute, and there's these outlying sort of secondary nobility, the younger sons and stuff like that, that are out there on the region making sure that everything works. And this is lots of, you know, I have lots of names down here of the people that work this out. I'm not making this part up. That maps on, as a structure, that maps right onto Chaco. This is a map, and, you know, it's a weird map, but of downtown Chaco with a half a dozen really big great houses, and these are contour lines and roads and stuff. But there's a kind of dense area where you have a half dozen really big great houses and, you know, some smaller ones and some other monumental structures. But those are these. Because there isn't one great house that's clearly bigger or better than the rest of them, even though we keep looking at Benito as being more, maybe a bit more than the others. And then you take it to the region, all right? And that map I showed you of Chaco's region, that's this. With all these outlying great houses, those are these guys. And all the little dots are the little commoner houses that are all through this. And you wind up with a population pyramid of, you know, 50,000, 55,000 commoners and 5,000 people at the top, scattered between the, you know, people in Chaco and the secondary nobility that are out in the canyon side. That really works, and I'm not aware of any other ethnographic model that fits Chaco. That's a common lament, is there is no ethnographic model that fits Chaco. Yeah, there is. The ethnohistoric model, very well documented. All we have to do is get past the glass ceiling, beyond the Great Walls, and I'm not saying that we solved Chaco's mystery, but we sure as heck would know a lot more about it. Chaco's at Tepetl. As nobles and commoners, half a dozen noble families rotating kingship, I suppose. I mean, there's not one great house that's clearly bigger and better than the others. City and countryside, tribute and taxes, think of all that stuff that's coming into Chaco, a bulk economy that's getting sucked into Chaco. And the scale is about right. So that's it. Thank you very much for your patience.